Okay. The Minister will take questions at the end of his statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. Minister, I call you to make the statement. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and can I welcome you to your new role. I welcome the opportunity to update the Parliament on the provisional outturn against the budget for the financial year 2020-21. The provisional outturn demonstrates once again that this government is prudently and competently managing Scotland's finances, even more so in these extremely challenging and uncertain times, taking into account, as it does, all of the COVID-19 expenditure up to 31st March. The financial challenges of managing our response to the pandemic have been unprecedented. This is an economic crisis as well as a health crisis, and the COVID-19 pandemic has been the biggest fiscal and policy challenge facing the Scottish Government over the past two decades of devolution. The pandemic has reached almost every area of our lives and has required the Scottish Government to respond quickly and decisively, providing substantial additional funding for public services and support for individuals, businesses and the economy. Whilst our collective efforts, in tandem with the success of the vaccination programme, are helping us to win the fight to overcome the virus, this has not come without cost. I would like to personally thank the members of the NHS, emergency services and frontline staff across the whole of the public sector for the amazing work they have done over the past year. I would also like to recognise businesses and the public for the sacrifices they have made. Every penny received by the Scottish Government to tackle COVID-19 has been channelled to where it was needed the most. To date, we have announced over 170 COVID initiatives, providing bespoke financial support to businesses, individuals and organisations to support them through the pandemic. In 2020-21, we allocated more than £9 billion to support the health, economic and social challenges created by this pandemic. This is more than the COVID funding passed to us by the UK Government. This includes over £3 billion to support health and wider public health initiatives, over £3 billion to support Scottish businesses, £1 billion to local government to support the welfare and well-being of our communities, £850 million to support our rail and bus networks, and £450 million to support education and skills. These figures demonstrate the scale and breadth of our response to this unprecedented situation. It is against this extremely challenging financial backdrop that we report our provisional outturn today. Although the path to recovery remains uncertain, the Scottish Government remains committed in ensuring that, as a country, we get back on our feet and the right steps are taken to support and guide Scotland's longer-term recovery. Presiding Officer, the pandemic has put a spotlight on the challenges we face with having such restricted fiscal powers. There is an imbalance between the risks which the Scottish Budget is exposed to and the levers that we have to manage those risks. This includes strict limits on how much and for what purpose the Scottish Government can borrow, leading us to be overly dependent on UK Government policy. There is the time lag between the UK Government's announcements and the confirmation of further devolved funding, making real-time response and recovery planning extremely difficult. The uncertainty of the funding and application of certain COVID policies when there needed to be varying local responses to the pandemic, a prime example being the furlough scheme, and the single-year funding model, which means carry-forward of our budget between financial years is extremely restricted. COVID-19, unfortunately, does not stop at the end of a financial year. The 2020-21 guarantee on Barnett consequentials provided by the UK Government was a welcome development. However, this only served to reduce the risk of late deductions to our budget, which we are again facing for 2021-22. What is not in doubt is that significant budget challenges lie ahead, and these funding challenges will continue as we target our resources at stimulating a safe, swift and sustainable recovery for our communities, our public services and our economy. There remains significant uncertainty over the extent to which the UK Government will support the ongoing cost of the pandemic, which is why we have requested a guarantee of funding for future funding similar to that in 2020-21. This is why I, along with the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Economy, will also continue to make the case to the UK Government for more proportionate fiscal powers to help manage pressures and volatility in Scotland's financial position and to allow the Scottish Government to respond fully to this crisis. The forthcoming fiscal framework review must take place in that context. A narrow technical review of the framework will not deliver what the people of Scotland need or want. Turning now to the 2020-21 provisional outturn. Under the current devolution settlement, the Scottish Parliament is not permitted to overspend its budget. At the same time, the carry-forward of budget between financial years is highly restrictive, meaning that phasing of expenditure between financial years is extremely restricted. There is, therefore, a balance to be struck to ensure we maintain spend within our budget limits, but do not generate high carry-forwards between financial years that would risk breaching a reserve cap and result in the loss of funding. We have once again managed to maintain this balance. I can report that the provisional outturn for 2020-21 is £48 billion against a total fiscal budget of £48.5 billion. The remaining budget of £449 million, which represents just 0.9% of our total budget, has been carried forward in full through the Scotland Reserve. This was proactively managed, with £431 million already being anticipated within the 2021-22 budget reserve carry forward. It is therefore important to note that there is no loss of spending power to the Scottish Government as a result of this carry forward. Every penny has been allocated in full, allowing us to implement COVID response measures at the most optimal time, rather than being constrained to a single financial year. The £449 million is made up of £374 million fiscal resource, £8 million capital and £67 million financial transactions, which, of course, can only be used for loans or equity investments in entities outside of the public sector. The provisional outturn is in line with our strategy to actively minimise the amount of capital in the reserve to create headrooms for the FTs and resource carry-forwards, which are required to support the 2021-22 budget position agreed by Parliament. I highlight that these outturn figures for 2020-21 remain provisional, as they are subject to an ongoing audit process. Finalised figures will be reported as usual in the annual Scottish Government consolidated accounts, and a statement of total outturn for the financial year 2020-21 later this year. To conclude, the provisional outturn demonstrates that the Scottish Government has maintained a firm grip on Scotland's public finances in the context of a year which has presented the most significant financial challenges in the last two decades of devolution. We have demonstrated that once again the Scottish Government has effectively managed Scotland's public finances and have maintained the balance of not breaching our fixed budgetary limits and ensuring the reserve balances will be deployed in full to fund 2021-22 spending priorities. And I commend today's figures to Parliament.
Thank you. The Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we will move on to the next item of business. It would be helpful if members who wish to ask a question were to press the request to speak buttons now. I call Liz Smith.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I first of all join the Minister in thanking all those who have been very much on the front line as we grapple with the pandemic, which is obviously forcing Scotland to face up to very difficult circumstances. Indeed, it just takes a quick look at yesterday's statistics published to recognise the scale of the challenge which lie ahead, especially when it comes to securing people's jobs. And of course, these challenges are budgetary too. I have three questions, Minister. And first of all, can I turn to the underspend and the concerns that the ongoing, very serious pandemic, there continues to be, obviously, a large sum of public money which many sectors want to see spent as a matter of urgent support. For example, there is an underspend in the health budget of £183 million. And at the same time, as obviously there is a backlog of health treatment, so these are very serious issues. Can I ask the Minister to provide the Parliament with very full transparency within the budget lines as to exactly how the COVID recovery money, including that that is provided to Scotland by the UK Government, has been spent and how it will be spent across each sector? Secondly, in relation to transport, which is once again the largest underspend and which comes just days after the Scottish Government announced that it had missed its climate change targets for the third year running, what money will be given to green transport and infrastructure projects to ensure that the effects of climate change will be mitigated? And finally, the First Minister was accused by members of the National Economic Forum this week that not nearly enough effort has been made by the Scottish Government to provide business community with that meaningful engagement when it comes to planning ahead for the future. So can I ask the Minister what is being done to urgently address that problem?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I take this opportunity to welcome Liz Smith to her new position. I would just like to pick up on that last point and recognise the outstanding contribution that our businesses have made throughout this pandemic. I'm sure we can all think of examples in our own constituencies of businesses going above and beyond the call of duty, and she's absolutely correct to raise that today. I'll turn to each of the points she raised in turn. With regard to the health underspend, that came about due to late consequentials of £200 million. And it was judged that this was not going to align with public health spending cycles. So as I made reference to in my statement, it is better that that money is deployed at the optimum moment rather than just to fit within the strictures of a financial year. Within transport, there has been money that has been underspent in capital. This is ultimately just a consequence of the restrictions and the pandemic. And I think that is something you will see across a lot of capital lines. With restrictions in place, with construction closed for large parts of last year, that inevitably has led to some slippage within capital. However, there has been money that has been redeployed from capital for purposes of green transport, and I would be happy to provide more detail to the member in writing if that is something she would desire. With regards to business support and the overall question of how much money has been deployed, the Scottish Government has received in total £8.6 billion of consequentials, but we have went further and spent over £9 billion in supporting our communities through the pandemic. With specific regard to business, the total is over £3 billion. That includes £2.6 billion in various grant schemes, amounting to over 170 bespoke financial support packages for businesses and their communities. There is also the support we have given in non-domestic rate relief. We are the only part of the UK to give non-domestic rate relief of 100% to retail, hospitality, leisure and aviation. And that is a commitment we have delivered that would in total cost over £960 million. So I hope that demonstrates to Liz Smith that this government is absolutely committed to business. It has supported business through this pandemic and it will continue to do so. But can I say this, there would be so much more that we could do if we had these additional fiscal levers. So I sincerely hope that Liz Smith will use what influence she has within her party to encourage the Chancellor to engage constructively in talks with the Scottish Government, with the Cabinet Secretary, as we take forward the fiscal framework review.
Daniel Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I thank the Minister for early sight of the statement and indeed welcome him to his position. A £449 million underspend, while so many businesses are struggling to keep their head above water, will seem like a cruel irony to many. And I understand that the timing of some of these funds from the UK Government might have made an underspend unavoidable. However, the lack of clarity about what the substantial figure is being used for is not so understandable. In particular, with the extension of restrictions, the deepening cash flow crisis may prove terminal for businesses such as taxi drivers, wedding planners, hospitality to tourism. So can the Minister provide more detail on how these apparently allocated funds have been allocated and confirm that they're being spent to support these businesses impacted by that extension of restrictions? Can he also set out plans to improve the transparency of COVID funds as called for by the Auditor General in February? And can I come back to the issue of health spend? Because how can the Scottish Government manage an underspend in the health budget in the middle of a health crisis?
Sorry. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank Daniel Johnson for his questions? Turning to his last point about health spending, which I addressed in my response to Liz Smith, these were very late consequentials that arrived in February. And I'm sure the member would agree with every member across this chamber that what should determine how money is spent in health is how it can be spent in a way that delivers the optimal impact, rather than just to be within the strictures of a financial year. And I'm sure on reflection that the member will come round to that point of view. On regard to the underspend overall, as I have explained and set out in my statement, this has been managed prudently through the Scotland Reserve. Indeed, £431 million of this was anticipated in the budget. And with regards to transparency around how this money has been spent, we had the unprecedented step of a summer budget revision in the last financial year. So the Cabinet Secretary has been engaged fully with this Parliament, with the then Finance and Constitution Committee, and indeed will be writing to the newly constituted Finance and Public Administration Committee ahead of summer recess to illustrate what our thinking is going forward. And of course, we will all be happy to appear before committee in due course.
Before calling the next speaker, questioner, can I just point out that we've got quite a number of members seeking to ask a question, so if we could have more succinct questions and more succinct answers, Minister, that would be really helpful. Kenny Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to welcome both you and the Minister to your new posts. The pandemic has shone a spotlight on the need for additional fiscal flexibilities to be devolved to Scotland on an ongoing basis, including greater borrowing powers, reserve limits and year-end flexibility. These powers are essential to secure and consolidate a strong recovery from this crisis. The Minister has mentioned engagement. Can he advise what engagement the Scottish Government has had to date with the UK Government about the devolution of future fiscal flexibilities?
Minister.
Can I thank Mr Gibson for his question, and he is absolutely right to correct to raise the issues that he does. The key challenge that we have had throughout is the fluidity of the overall funding position. Is when announcements are made, we do not know when we will receive the consequentials. Where we did have the Barnett guarantee last year, we currently do not have the Barnett guarantee, so we do not know about negative consequentials. This makes budget planning extremely difficult in normal times. That is compounded in the context of a pandemic. The Cabinet Secretary has written to the Chancellor looking to set up a quadrilateral meeting with the other devolved administrations. Very much hope that the Chancellor will take this option up. We are obviously looking forward to take forward the fiscal review next year. And what is key for taking forward the fiscal review is ensuring that the remit of that is as broad as possible. And I hope together as a Parliament we can work to ensure that this Parliament receives the powers that it needs so that we can fully respond to the crisis and take Scotland forward in recovery.
Dr. Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I refer members to my entry in the Register of Members' Interests, which shows that I'm still a member of Aberdeen City Council. From talking to other local councils, there's still real pressures when it comes to funding in local government. And I know the Minister will quote more money for local government, but of course most of that is coming in and going straight back out again for business support and ring-fenced initiatives. Will the Minister commit to using some of the underspend to support local government, who are doing so much work in local communities?
Minister.
Can I thank the member for his question and welcome to the Parliament. It's the first opportunity I've had to do so. And I also want to join him in recognising the extraordinary contribution from local government throughout this pandemic. All of the money that has been carried forward in the reserve is committed. £430 million of that was anticipated within the budget process. So that forms part of the overall local government settlement that was agreed by Parliament earlier this year. With regards to local government funding throughout the pandemic, in excess of £1 billion was given on top of the funding already allocated in the budget last year. And this funding has went to supporting the wellbeing and welfare of our communities, supporting initiatives to support people on low incomes, free school meals and winter support packages. If the member would like to discuss these matters further, there will be the opportunity going into the budget process later in the year, and I'm more than happy to engage going forward.
John Mason.
Thank you. Can I commend the government on being so accurate with its budgeting coming within 0.9%? Can the minister say anything about tax volatility? Because COVID is likely to lead to some uncertainty around tax.
Minister.
Can I thank John Mason for his question? He is absolutely correct to raise the issue of volatility. This is something that is addressed within the medium-term financial strategy, and it is also why we have prudently used our resource borrowing powers to mitigate that volatility. Clearly, there would be more we could do if we had further powers in this Parliament, so I would reiterate the calls that I have made already for people across the Parliament to work together ahead of the fiscal framework review to ensure that we can have the powers in this Parliament that we require to fully manage volatility.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Last year, the government gave £191 million no-strings subsidy to private bus company owners and underspent the transport budget by £343 million. So will the government, when it's carrying forward this money into the reserve, consider taking equity stakes in bus companies and other transport firms going forward to extend public ownership across the transport system to better enable us to have an integrated, greener public transport system in Scotland?
Minister.
I thank the member for his question. I will take this opportunity to welcome to the chamber as well. On the substantive point he raised, I am happy to reflect upon that. On the specific issue of money going to bus companies, I referenced that in an earlier answer. There was an underspend in that area, but that money has been carried forward as part of the Scotland Reserve to be redeployed on frontline spending in this financial year.
Patrick Harvey.
Thank you, and I congratulate Tom Arthur on his appointment as a minister. No doubt it's a difficult job, but there is a concern that in managing its own finances, the Scottish Government has pushed some of the pressure down the chain to local government and to arm's length bodies like Glasgow Life. What more is the Scottish Government intending to do to ensure that facilities run by such bodies, like White Inch Library, about which decisions are being made this afternoon, and many other libraries, leisure centres, community centres, are not lost as we see COVID recovery? What more will the government do to ensure that those kind of services are protected?
Minister.
Can I thank Patrick Harvey for his question? I absolutely recognise the vital importance of these local services to our communities. As Patrick Harvey knows well, the budget for local government is set as part of the overall budget, and it is ultimately a matter for local authorities to decide how they spend these resources. But I'm sure this will be a topic that will be of much discussion as we approach the budget process later on this year.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the Minister to his position. The Minister has already touched upon the fact that the Scottish Government cannot overspend its budget, so must balance it throughout the year. So can the Minister provide any details to how the current percentage underspend compares to other devolved governments required to balance a budget, such as the Labour Government in Wales?
Minister.
Yes, I'd be happy to. Mr McMillan is absolutely correct to raise the fact that we cannot overspend our budget, and indeed we have a very narrow envelope in which to enable us to carry forward any additional resource to the following year. So underspend for 2020-21 is in line with comparative years. The 2020-21 data for example, the Labour government in Wales is not yet available. However, I can confirm that their underspend in 2019-2020 was £189 million, which represents 1.3% of their total budget, which compares to the underspend of 0.9% in this year's Scottish budget.
Willie Rennie.
When businesses, especially tourism businesses, are crying out for support, they will find it baffling that millions of pounds of business support is stuck in government accounts. The Minister cutely dodged Daniel Johnson's question on how these funds have been allocated. So can he tell me how much of the underspend has been allocated to tourism businesses, especially those dependent on international visitors?
Minister.
Can I thank Willie Rennie for his question? We spend every penny of resource that we receive. And what I would say to Mr Rennie is that the £431 million of this carry forward was anticipated in the Scottish budget. And if I recall correctly, Mr Rennie voted for that budget.
Willie Coffey, who's joining us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The economic shock of the pandemic has been compounded by the shock caused by the Tories' Brexit disaster. Can the Minister advise what steps the Scottish Government is taking to mitigate the impacts of Brexit on Scotland's public finances?
Minister.
Can I thank Mr Coffey for his question? He is absolutely correct to raise the issue of Brexit. The pandemic, of course, has been the biggest economic challenge we have faced in the last decade, but this has been compounded by Brexit. But what the provisional outturn shows is that, once again, as I indicated in the statement, the Scottish Government is prudentially and competently managing Scotland's finances, even against this most challenging of backdrop. We have been clear throughout that we will do all we can to support businesses throughout this pandemic, and we will continue to do that, and also to support businesses that are impacted by Brexit.
Tess White.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I also welcome the Minister to his role. The Minister says, and I quote, to date over 170 COVID initiatives providing bespoke financial support to businesses to support them through the pandemic have been announced. The fact is that too many people in the business community are telling us that they are not receiving the support they need, and it is not clear who can access what. And it is not clear the timescales for business support grants. Businesses are complaining about the lack of engagement from this government. One question. May I ask the Minister what he's going to do about this lack of engagement and when? Thank you.
Minister?
Along with the First Minister, the Deputy First Minister, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance, I had extensive engagements with businesses yesterday morning as part of the National Economic Forum, and I will continue to do so.
Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and welcome to your new post. And thank you, Minister, for his clear statement and welcome him to his new role. Can the Minister provide any further detail as to what measures the Scottish Government is taking to provide certainty for our vital public services during this difficult time?
Minister.
Can I thank Bill Kidd for his question? Due to our prudent management of Scotland's finances, the Scottish Government was able to protect our most vital public services without overspending our budget. During the last financial year, we have responded to the pandemic by allocating an additional £3 billion to health and wider health initiatives, an extra £1 billion to local government through measures such as our lost income support scheme, winter support packages and free school meal scheme, ensured our rail and bus networks remain sustainable via an additional £850 million of funding, and provided an extra £450 million to education to ensure extensive support measures could be implemented.
And Jimmy Halko-Johnson.
Thank you. Can I welcome the Minister to his new position? And as he's rightly identified, this is now an economic crisis as much as a health crisis, and so how these public funds are used is vitally important. But the last publicly available minutes on the Scottish Government's website for a meeting of the First Minister's Council on Economic Advisers is from June 2020. So could I ask the Minister whether that is the last time the group met, and when the next meeting of that group and also the Advisory Group on Economic Recovery is scheduled to be, and whether there are any plans to amend the membership of either of those groups to give a stronger voice to Scotland's business community?
Minister?
Thank Jamie Halkrow-Johnson for his question. I didn't catch all of his question, but no, the body that he refers to has met since then. And so I apologise, I didn't pick up the rest of his question, but if the member wants to write to him, I'll be happy to respond to him.
Thank you, Minister. And that concludes the statement. We'll move now on to the next item of business.